شكرا جزيلا دكتور عمر على تقديم يعني هوب ان انا استحقه، وانا بشكر طبعا دكتور حمزه وانا عارف. النو اكس ار اكسباندينج ان انديكيشنز اند بوتينج مور بن اون ذا ماب اوف كارديولوجي تريتمنت افري داي. فيرست كانت الاي اف والفي تي اي، دلوقتي في الاكوت كورونري سيندروم. And if you're looking to a quick answer of the question, what's the role of NOAC in pulmonary embolism now, it has a role in the initial anticoagulation, the maintenance, and the extended anticoagulation, especially in cancer patients. But if we want to know how and why and when, you must bear with me. And all these evidence are derived primarily by the European Society of Cardiology recent guidelines to 2019 about the management of acute pulmonary embolism. So we have a case of a 65-year-old female. She has a breast cancer on hormonal targeted therapy. She has an attack of dyspnea, chest discomfort, and ear hunger, and she was rushed to the ER. The primary examination showed a blood pressure of 110 over 70, heart rate of 112 beat per minute, respiratory rate of 35 breath per minute, temperature was not high, mental status was intact, oxygen saturation was also above 90, and creatinine clearance was 50 milliliter per minute, and the ECG shows clearly the picture of changes of pulmonary embolism with right ventricular, severe right ventricular strain. As this patient is a very high risk patient and has a very high probability of pulmonary embolism, so the CTPA was chosen as a diagnostic tool to prove or roll out pulmonary embolism, and it shows signs of right ventricular dysfunction and a huge thrombus mainly in the left brain, pulmonary branch. And the troponin of the patient was positive. So in this patient, it's time to risk stratify the severity of the pulmonary embolism. And we have the pulmonary embolism severity index and the simplified form of it that showed clearly that this patient has a very high risk of mortality at the 30 days hospitalization. So this patient is put now at the category of intermediate high-risk patient. Why it's not in the high-risk patient? Because of the hemodynamic stability of the patient. The patient is not shocked, the oxygen saturation is not below 90, so this patient is in the intermediate to risk high category. And according to the treatment algorithm or the initial management algorithm, this patient should be anticoagulated, should be hospitalized with a very close monitoring, because this patient can deteriorate at any moment, requiring the management of high risk, which is under thrombolysis, either thrombolysis or catheter targeted therapy or surgical intervention. It's very important to clarify the bleeding risk of this patient. This patient is old age, has cancer, and will be subjected to all form of anticoagulation, so bleeding risk stratification is very important. And if you're planning to use NOAC, so the VTE bleed risk model is to be used, because this is the only model who discussed the use of of NOAC as an anticoagulation. And of course, this patient has a very high risk of bleeding, of course. So we are dealing with an old patient with cancer, with an intermediate to high risk for pulmonary embolism, and with high bleeding risk. So when we choose the anticoagulant regimen, we must choose a regimen that is potent and safe at the same time. And in the meta-analysis of NOAC versus VKA, this is the NOAC showed that it has less recurrence incidence of pulmonary embolism or VTE, and with a safer profile than the vitamin K antagonists. And when you put the NOAC versus the low molecular weight heparin, it shows that it has a less higher incidence of bleeding. Yes, the bleeding is higher with the NOAC, but it was not significant in the meta-analysis, but it has a lesser incidence of recurrence. And of course, when we do test the NOAC versus placebo in extended therapy, the recurrence is less higher, but the bleeding is more high because this patient is not receiving any true anticoagulation in the placebo arm. And this made the recommendations of the initial therapy of the patient. Any patient with acute pulmonary embolism should be anticoagulated. Low molecular weight heparin is the treatment of choice initially. Then NOAC, if indicated, is superior than VKA. If VKA is indicated, the INR must be above 2.5. And it's very important to know the contraindication for NOAC. NOAC are contraindicated in pregnant female, lactating female, in patient with antiphospholipid antibody syndrome and severe renal impairment, creatinine clearance less than 15. So when to start NOAC? Is it to start immediately, especially in this patient? No. The trials that discussed the use of thrombolytic therapy in pulmonary embolism discovered that the patients with high intermediate risk patients can develop high risk pulmonary embolism situation and hemodynamic stability for 2 or 3 days after presentation. So it's wise to wait for 2 or 3 days on initial parenteral low molecular weight heparin before shifting this patient to oral anticoagulation. And why the NOACs are contraindicated in antiphospholipid antibody syndrome? Because when we tested the rivaroxaban as a NOAC versus the VKA antagonist in these patients, we found that the primary endpoints were extremely worse at the arm of rivaroxaban, derived mainly by the recurrence of fatal pulmonary embolism. It's very important to know the doses initially to start with in the various types of NOACs, dabigatran, rivaroxaban, apixaban, and edoxaban, and to know what's our limitation. Dabigatran is not preferred to be used at creatinine clearance less than 30. Edoxaban should be reduced to 30 milligram once if the creatinine clearance is between 15 and 30. It goes also with the rivaroxaban, and it's contraindicated to use any NOAC in a creatinine clearance below 15. So for how long? All patients should receive anticoagulation, oral anticoagulation if indicated, for at least 3 months. After 3 months, we will decide either to stop or to continue. To stop in what patient? In patients with a clear major risk factor that was reversible or cured. This patient has a class 1 indication to stop anticoagulation. To extend anticoagulation, either in patients with antiphospholipid antibody syndrome or in patients with recurrent VTE not related to a major risk factor. So these patients have a class 1 indication to continue anticoagulation. The new recommendations is to extend the anticoagulation in a first episode of VTE with patient either with no risk factors or with no obvious risk factors, or with a permanent risk factor that was not cured or cannot be cured, or related to a minor risk factor that cannot explain the attack of VTE. These patients should have extended anticoagulation. And if we are extending the anticoagulation using NOAC, we should reduce the dose of NOAC of a rivaroxaban to 10 milligram once per day, or apixaban to 2.5 milligram twice per day. And why we are in need of extending oral anticoagulation? Because with time, the instance of recurrence of VTE is increasing and not decreasing. So the patient that has no extension of anticoagulation and has 5 years after the first attack, this patient has an incidence of recurrence of 36%. So the danger is increasing and not decreasing in these patients. And extension with apixaban or rivaroxaban had very, very less incidence of recurrence and a very safe profile. And this was the example also with the rivaroxaban. Of course, the dose of 10 milligram and not the conventional 20 milligram. So in patient with cancer, the indications are totally different. The extension of anticoagulation is preferably low molecular weight heparin over VKA, NOAX over VKA, especially edoxaban and rivaroxaban. Patient with cancer should be considered of an indefinite period until the cancer is completely cured. Do not stop the anticoagulation until the cancer is completely cured. And if the patient was discovered incidentally to have pulmonary embolism during any examination, he should be treated as if he has asymptomatic pulmonary embolism, as they are carrying the same risk. And again, the evidence, low molecular weight heparin has a less recurrence and more safety profile than VKA in patients with cancer, and so does NOAX and in edoxaban or rivaroxaban. So we can discharge the patient early or not. In the Histia exclusion criteria, which is a very good criteria presented in these guidelines, if any of these questions is answered with yes, we cannot discharge the patient early. And we're talking about 24 to 48 hours after presentation. If any of them are answered with yes, we cannot discharge these patients. So back to our patient. Our patient had fondaparinux 7.5 milligram once daily for 3 days, followed by rivaroxaban 15 milligram twice daily for 3 weeks. Then she was shifted to rivaroxaban 20 milligram once daily. The plan is to follow her up every 3 months and to continue anticoagulation till the cancer is completely cured. To summarize, NOACs are now superior to VKA in initial and long-term anticoagulation in VT pulmonary embolism patient. They have also less bleeding incidence. The dose of rivaroxaban and apixaban should be reduced after 6 months. Rivaroxaban and edoxaban can be used in extended treatment of cancer patient except for GIT cancer. NOAC are contraindicated in pregnancy, severe renal impairment, creatinine clearance below 15, and in antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. And of course, risk stratification, including bleeding risk, is extremely important to derive the management. And thank you.